Hello, I'm Joe Clark and I'm pleased to present our first part of a new series, Cargo Ships and Tankers, The Golden Age. The film has been compiled of clips from archive film taken mostly by passengers on passing passenger ships and by bystanders in harbours and ports. Some was also taken by crew members serving in these ships. Ships they loved, and ships that are no more. As the film has been restored, the quality varies. Some is in black and white, and some in colour. Sit back now and bring back those precious memories. So, here we are. In a Dutch port during the Depression with several general cargo ships lined up, some still in service, others not. The mid-1930s saw a lot of ships laid up in various places around the world. We think these clips were taken in Rotterdam. These ships are clearly not in employment. But anyway, some ships were working, and we move now to the Panama Canal. There's some ships here approaching the locks. Unfortunately, we can't identify every single ship in the film. There is one we can identify, the Delftdijk, built in 1929 by Wilton Rotterdam for Holland America Line. She's 10,220 gross tons. She was later sold to the Chinese and scrapped in 1966. We're at the Atlantic end, at the Guatam Locks. We see a few more ships here passing, which are unidentified. And a curious biplane passes overhead. As I speak now, and it's January 2015, the Panama Canal is being widened to take much larger ships than these. Staying in the Panama Canal, our film now switches into colour. And the first ship we look at is the Primos. The films you see here were taken by passengers on the Canberra, and they're not necessarily in sequence, as they were taken by different people. Primos was a German reefer, a refrigerated cargo ship built in 1959 by Keeler Havelsteck in Kiel. She's flying the West German flag. In 1969 she was sold to Greek interests and renamed Santa Trinidad. Her job was mainly spot cargo, tramping, used mainly for fruit. She sank after a fire in November 1974 whilst on a voyage from Jeddah to Singapore in ballast. She appears to be in exceptionally good condition. Her paintwork is immaculate. Primos was 3,027 gross registered tonnage. The next picture is slightly misty because I had come out of an air-conditioned room onto the deck. The ship is the Pasadena, built in 1953 by Deutsche Werft Finkenwerder for the East Asiatic Company, Copenhagen. She's 8,607 gross tons. She was scrapped in 1979. Back in the locks, the ship with the black hull and reddish funnel is the Excalibur, originally the USS Dutchess, a Windsor-class attack transport of 9,644 tons. She was sold in 1948 to the American Export Lines and renamed Excalibur, and traded as a passenger cargo liner. I think we can safely say that this ship was cruising at this stage because their services were normally from the United States and Canada's East Coast ports to the Mediterranean. Our next ship with a rather rusty hull was the Ames Victory, built in 1945 by the Oregon Shipbuilding Corporation, Portland, for the US government. She's 7,606 gross tonnage. She was sold in 1949 to a private company, Victoria Carriers Inc. She was scrapped in 1970. Her trade was spot cargo and tramping. If you're lucky enough to be high up in the Panama Canal, it's a wonderful way for ship spotting. The ship here is the Bulk Carrier Media, built in 1963 by A.G. Wesser Bremen for Wallenius Lines. The Media was 17,879 gross registered tonnage. She was sold in 1977 to the Greeks and renamed Lydia. She was sold again in 1987 to Gibraltar Interests and renamed Lydia T, and was scrapped in China in the same year. Whilst we're still in the Panama Canal, we see the Rohini, passenger cargo ship, built in 1951 by John Brown and Company, Clydebank, for the New Zealand Shipping Company Limited. She was 17,851 gross tons. In 1966, ownership was transferred to the Federal Steam Navigation Company. She was scrapped in 1974. I'll go back to some black and white footage. And this is of Colombo Harbour with numerous cargo ships waiting to load or unload. Behind Strathaird, which at that time had three funnels, we see the BI ship Mashobra, built in 1920 by Barclay Curl. She was 8,300 gross tons. Soon after the beginning of the war, she took part in the Narvik campaign and was bombed. She had to be beached, and the ship was destroyed when Narvik was evacuated. There's a Brocklebank Line cargo ship in the foreground, the one in the centre astern of the Orcades II. Now we move to the 50s and the film is in colour. We're still in Colombo Harbour and you can see the number of ships that are waiting, as I said before, to be loaded or unloaded. It's very difficult to identify a lot of these ships, mostly under foreign flags, but this one would seem to be a BI cargo ship. And some of you will recognize her. The ship with the blue hull is the Joanna's Mess. She was built in 1953 and scrapped in 1979. In front of her, the 7,200 gross tonnage Soshi Maru, built in 1953 and scrapped in 1977. The Suez Canal was also a very busy area for shipping, and here we are in port side, several ships lining up to go through the canal. This ship could be the Chantilly, built originally as a Kerguelen. She was bought by Messeries Maritime and renamed Chantilly and completed in 1924. She's 10,000 tons and had a long life and was scrapped in 1952. Now we see some of these ships going through the canal themselves. They're a mixed bunch. Tankers, cargo ships, quite often passenger liners. This picture has been taken from a car window. And here we are at the other end of the canal. At Suez, the ships are anchored here, waiting to go through. Coming into view is the Blue Funnel 10,000 ton Pyrrhus, built in 1949. So we're moving from Suez and we're going through the Suez Canal in the Hamburg, a passenger cargo ship built in 1954 by Bremer Vulcan Visak for Hamburg America Lines. She was 9,000 gross registered tons. The Hamburg America Line, HAPAG as it was known, had extensive worldwide services from Hong Kong, Bremen, Rotterdam or Amsterdam. At this time she was running from Hong Kong to the UK. We'll stay with the Hamburg for a while and see some shots of her from various angles and some onboard shots. On her way out to Hong Kong in this instance, she ran into some fairly rough weather in the Indian Ocean. That was not so unusual, but somehow or other when you passed Aden and headed out into the Indian Ocean and fair weather, you expected smooth seas all the way to your destination. Happy memories of blue skies and flying fish. Not always accurate, as memory is eroded by time. And so here we are in Hong Kong, in Kowloon to be precise. The ship you're about to see is a Taurus, built in 1948. She was built for Williamson. The ship in the background is the President Cleveland. Staying in Hong Kong, we have a look around the harbour. There were some wonderful scenes in the 1950s and 60s. Apart from the junks, there was always plenty of merchant shipping to be seen, quite a lot of it red-flagged. Nowadays, sadly, even the harbour has been reduced in size. And now, for those who loved tankers, we're going to have a complete change and join the El Merlo. We see her in dry dock having a new propeller fitted. El Merlo was built by Blythewood Shipping Company Limited in Glasgow. She was completed in 1930 and was 8,000 and 88 gross registered tonnage. Her owners, Libitus Oilfields Limited. El Merlo survived the war. There are stories of her being fitted with a Japanese 6-inch gun, which didn't work. Anyway, we're now in more peaceful times, and although I have no way of proving it, I have reason to believe that this film was taken while she was on time charter to Regent. So we're going to join the crew for a while and watch them as they go about their daily routine. I would say, almost without a doubt, we're in Curaçao here. And now we're passing through the Panama Canal. The chief engineer passes by on an inspection. And the captain comes out of his cabin. Others are less formally dressed. The main deck is awash in rough seas. On the bridge, the sextants are out for the noonday positions. And the lifeboats are inspected, as they are at regular intervals. The captain comes down on inspection. But he's not the one in the short shorts. And some of the crew enjoy a well-earned rest ashore. We're going to stay in black and white, and we're now in the King George V dock in London. We're about to see the P&O ship Ranchi of 16,650 gross tons. She was a passenger cargo ship. She had one funnel removed in 1939 when she was fitted out as an armed merchant cruiser. There's some lovely old film here of the dockers working on the ships. there's clearly some very important cargo on these ships. I see a crate of Gordon's gin there, if I'm not mistaken. Although why they should be exporting it, I have no idea. I'm sure we could have been trusted to look after it. The ship we've been watching was the Calcas, built in 1921 by Workman Clark of Belfast for the Ocean Steamship Company, which we know as the Blue Funnel Line. She's 10,304 gross registered tons. She was sunk by torpedo in April 1941 whilst on passage to Sydney. In Sydney, we see BI's Belima, 1959, built by Harland and Wolff, of 6,796,000 gross registered tons. We see other cargo ships here in Pyrmont. Also in Sydney, we see the USS Mattapony, a tanker built in 1942 by the Sun Shipbuilding and Dry Dock Company in Pennsylvania. For the US Navy, she was 10,300 gross registered tons. Iliwa, built in 1951 by C. van der Giessen and Zonen. She's 9,849 gross registered tons. The Orient liner Oranze is making her way from Pyrmont towards the Harbour Bridge on her way back to London. As she does so, she passes the Waiwera, a ship built in 1944 by Harland and Wolff Belfast, the Shaw Savile and Albion Company Limited, of 12,000 gross registered tons. Here we see a United Fruit Company cargo ship in New York. We see here Steel Vendor, built in 1944 by the Western Pipe and Steel Company, San Francisco, for the U.S. War Shipping Administration Department. She was originally named the Sea Partridge, of 8,100 tons. She was renamed Steel Vendor in 1947. We move to Malta, where we see the Adriatica Line Bernina. She was built in 1959 and was 4,400 gross registered tons. We can move along now, and we see this coaster, lovely little ship. That's followed by another small cargo ship. And then we come into some Far Eastern harbour where we meet up with our old friend the Taurus, which we last saw in Hong Kong Harbour. She was later renamed the Ruler and scrapped in 1971. This ship could be the Clan MacTavish. She was built in 1949 and was 10,880. tons. This is the New Zealand shipping company Papa Nui, built in 1943. Here we're clearly in San Francisco. We see the Oranze with a German freighter behind her. And from the Oranze we see the Papa Nui again. Now we come to the Carmen, a bulk carrier built in 1963 by A.G. Vesa Bremer for the Bolanus Lines. She was 17,876 gross registered tons and sailed under the Swedish flag. She was eventually scrapped in Shanghai in 1985. The Soviet cargo ship Zayels, built in 1964, of 2,900 gross registered tons. Next, the Greek ship Jade II, built in 1980, of 8,900 gross registered tons. More ships waiting to go through Suez. Now we have a series of shots of various cargo ships in different situations, none of which I can identify at this stage. We see here a couple of small coasters. This ship to me looks like an iron ore carrier, but I couldn't be sure. You'll see a small reefer cargo ship belonging to the Spanish. It's one of Compania Transmediterranean ships. It's the one with the yellow funnel and the red band. In a moment we'll see a Delmas cargo ship, a French company serving the west coast of Africa. We thought this ship silhouette might be a P&O Sudan or Somali, but it's not. But it's certainly British built. The ship behind the Orion is the Gilad Harati, built in 1957. She's 6,500 gross registered tons. Several more unidentified ships here in Colombo Harbour. The one in the distance behind the warship is the Zankirk of V&S. She's 9,000 tons. The Marineveldt of 1955 of the Hansa Line is 6,600 gross registered tons and is fitted with heavy lifting cargo gear and some refrigerated space. Now P&O Divana, built in 1947. She's 7,400 gross registered tons and was scrapped in Hong Kong in 1972. Cardiganshire is next. She is 7,700 tons. Still in Colombo, we see P&O's Dongola, built in 1946 and scrapped in 1964. Sticking with P&O, we see the Salmara, built in 1956, of 8,200 gross registered tonnage. And here we see the ill-fated Shillong, built in 1949, of 8,900 gross registered tons. She was sunk in a collision in 1957. We liner fellows used to think we got it rough. Here we see Perim in high seas. The Perim was built in 1945 and was 9,550 tons. We now join the Patonga as she makes her way around the world. Here we're in the Suez Canal. Patonga was built in 1952 for P&O. She was just over 10,000 tons. It's 8 bells. Well, you would have to be a copycat, wouldn't you? And why not let off a little bit of steam while we're at it? A low flying plane breaks the monotony. One of the lifeboat sails are raised and lowered as part of the practice. And the Goanese steward brings tea up to the bridge. We're out of the canal now and into the Indian Ocean, and the ship rocks gently in a light swell. Some of the deckhands going about their daily duties. On passage, she passes the Somali 3, built in 1948 at 9,000 tons. She was scrapped in 1973. Our deck officers come on to the wing of the bridge to take the noonday sights. An apprentice paints the rails. And here we find Patonga in Hong Kong Harbour. There'll be plenty of time here for a run ashore. Soon it's back to the old routine and long days at sea. A great way to cool off in their bathing costumes. Well, you wouldn't expect P&O officers to expose themselves now, would you? The deck crew all line up. Is it payday? And here's the most important member of the crew. Anchored once more, this time we're in Aden. The shadow is the Canton, also in Aden at the same time. The chief officer has gone up the foremast to take these pictures. And now we get a last look at Petonga as she comes in to her berth in London. In the background you'll see the anchor line Cilicia. Next is the Portuguese passenger liner Imperio. Launched in 1937, she was 13,186 gross tons. So we come back to the Panama Canal now and some shots taken from Canberra. It's always nice to watch ships going through the Panama Canal, even if you can't put a name to them. This is a Japanese K-Line cargo ship. This ship is too far away to identify for sure, but it looks like either the Sudan or the Somali. You will soon see the Steenkerk, built in 1961, another of the United Netherlands Navigation Company ships. She's 9,820 tons. Now we can have a look round Guernsey Harbour. Seems to be very busy with small ships. And here we have the Mersey Coast of Coastlines Limited. Became P&O in 1971. This ship was built in 1938 and was only 500 gross registered tons. Here we have the Soviet Poltava, built in 1962, of 11,081 gross registered tons. She was scrapped in 1989. Another ship passing through the Panama Canal, the Rocroi, a bulk carrier built in 1958, for Delmas of 11,900 gross registered tons. So here we have three ships, the Clan Allen, built in 1942 of 7,000 gross registered tons. And then behind her, the Hook Kirk, built in 1949 of 6,300 gross tons. Finally, the Rybeck Castle, built in 1948 for the Union Castle Line of 8,300 gross registered tons. Here we see the Harrison Line Inventor coming into Dar es Salaam. She was built in 1935 and was 6,200 gross tons. A smart little coaster. When I was younger and walking through Tilbury Docks, I used to look down on coasters like this and think, oh, I could drive that. I couldn't, of course. Here we have a Spanish reefer cargo ship of the Compania Transmediterranea. Coming up, we have a Soviet fish factory trawler, the Atlantique, a very early oil drill ship. A few more cargo ships of one sort or another, which are unidentified. Originally built as Sacramento for Ellemans Wilson Line, the 7,100-ton Felice, we now have the 1,500-ton Astrea of the Finland Steamship Company. Then we have Finn Merchant, built in 1953 by the Amsterdam Dry Dock Company for Oy Finn Lines Limited. It's 5,400 gross tons. In Naples, we see the Soviet passenger ship Litva of the Black Sea Shipping Company. She's 4,700 gross registered tons. The 4,400-ton Brunero of the Adriatica line. The Manchester Trader, built in 1941, of 5,600 gross registered tons. And then we see Manchester Spinner, built in 1952 by Camel Laird, Birkenhead for Manchester Liners Limited. She's 7,815 tons. And we're going to spend some time in the Manchester Ship Canal. Despite several setbacks during its construction, the canal was finally open to traffic in 1893. Although it was some 40 miles from the sea, the Manchester Ship Canal allowed the newly founded port of Manchester to establish itself, and it became the third busiest port in Britain. At its peak in 1958, the amount of freight carried by the canal was almost 20 million tons. Since then, the traffic on the canal has slowly decreased, with the size of the ships getting larger and larger. But plans are afoot to revive the fortunes of both the canal and the port, in conjunction with the Port of Liverpool through the Atlantic Gateway Scheme. We now see the Western Prince, built in 1955 by Holland and Wolff Belfast for the Prince Line. She's 7,917 tons. After 18 years' service, she eventually sank in the Pacific east of Japan on a voyage from Havana to Kobe, loaded with sugar. She was then called Mariner and under the Cypriot flag. We see the Manchester Trader again. She was scrapped in 1963 in Split, Yugoslavia, as it was then. Our next ship is the Castor. She was built in 1962 by Wärtsilä Turku for the Finland Steamship Company. Castor was 2,255 tons as originally built, but after being lengthened, she became 2,654 gross registered tonnage. She sank in July 1986 when carrying chemical waste and was eventually raised and scrapped in Bruges in 1989. We now move to the Tilbury docks and we see the Surrey, built in 1952 by Alexander Stephen and Son for the Federal Steam Navigation Company. And then the Jinshao, built in 1967 for the China Ocean Shipping Company. She's 11,170 gross tons. And we get a quick glimpse of the Eggery, built in 1957 for Elder Dempster. Now we join the Clan Lynan ship King Henry. She was 5,993 gross registered tons. She was built in 1958 and sold to the Greeks in 1972. We pass another Clan Lynan dry cargo ship. And here we see King Henry anchored. Back at sea, there's a mild swell and King Henry's rolling gradually from side to side. A lot of birds perching on board. Like many British merchant cargo ships, a swimming pool has been rigged on the after deck. And we can watch the crew as they go about their daily duties. There's always something to be done, and never quite enough time to do it in. Red sky in the morning, the sailor's warning. And as always, after a bit of rough sea, there's always some clearing up to be done. Land ho! King Henry arrives in New Zealand. The film that followed this was entirely shore scenes, but I couldn't resist putting in this little bit. If it works, don't fix it. We see this wonderful steam lorry on the docks. back home, another two Clan Line cargo ships. This is a general dry cargo ship, Clan McFarlane, built in 1947, of 7,176 tons. And behind her, the newer Clan Ranald, built in 1964, of 10,541 tons. Elders and Fife Covina, built in 1924. Elliman Lines, City of New York, built in 1947. Union Castles, the Hope Castle, of 13,152 tons. Then we have the 1958-built Chickanoa, an Elders and Fife Limited, British flagship of 6,200 gross tons. Two more banana boats of Elders and Fife, Golfito 1949 and Comito 1956. The Clan Ramsey, built in 1965, she's 10,500 tons. Two bunkering tankers, S.O. Tynemouth and S.O. Brixham, both of the S.O. Petroleum Company and used for bunkering ships. We go inside Tilbury Docks and we find the Belmar, a bulk carrier built in 1965. She's 12,950 tons and was operated by Leif Hogan Company of Norway. All of this film in Tilbury Dock was taken by Richard Clack back in the 1960s. Richard has supplied most of the information for this film, on which I've based my commentary. And here's the Fern Gulf, a bulk carrier. It's 13,731 tons and is registered to skips A.S. Kim and A.S. Glitter of Norway. Eurobates of 1961 and 9,650 tons. And now we can watch these lovely little coasters going past. The Sun Corona, built in 1959. She's 8,900 tons. A rather misty picture of the Briseis, built in 1957 for A.S. Granger, Rolfe and others, and operated by Fred Olsen Lines. The pictures here are of the tanker Sao El Furet, which was in a near collision with Canberra. If my memory serves me correctly, it was on Canberra's maiden voyage. That would have made a nasty dent. Here we're in the era before the supertanker. We used to see a lot of tankers around the Suez Canal area. Here you see one steaming behind a P&O liner. And here they're gathered in Suez waiting to go through the canal. You see two tankers here in Cape Town. We see here a BP tanker. It could be British Earl, built in 1945. Now, I'm aware that I've shown this clip before. It's an infamous scene of a Shell tanker on automatic pilot steering between Himalaya and the Chitral. She appears to have nobody on the bridge. The Esso Warwickshire, built in 1962 by A.G. Wesser of Bremen, she's just over 48,000 tons. P&O tanker Maloya, 12,763 tons. And now we have another large oil tanker of that period, the Toscana, a Williamson line tanker. She's seen here in Port Said. And now to finish off, we'll go back and have a look at some more cargo ships. Built in 1961, the Linguist of the Harrison Lines was 6,400 gross tons. Next is Shaw Savile's Majestic, built in 1967, of 12,135 tons. And then we see the Argentina, built in 1943 for the Johnson Line. She's 7,200 tons. And we're going to end part one of cargo ships and tankers with a picture of this little tramp steamer making heavy weather in a light swell.